see everyone here this morning that's able to make it. Pray for Lil, she gets to feeling better. Pray for the church in Holly as they are in process of seeking the Lord's leadership and calling a pastor, Brother Hopkins, after over 50 years, has retired from pastoring. He's started that work. That work was started out of this church and back in the 50s, I believe he said. What? No? Okay.
65.
Oh, in 65.
May of 60.
Decade off there. Okay. Back in the 60s, and there in Holly, and he's been there ever since. So that's pray for them as they're seeking the Lord's leadership in calling another pastor. And they'll be having a revival meeting first full week, I guess, in April. It's the same week that Lou and I, Lord willing, will be leaving to go to Mississippi at the end of that week. So I forget the exact dates, but I know the 6th falls in there somewhere. I think 6th is a Thursday. So that Monday through Friday, they'll be having a revival meeting. Brother Tom Ross, having him come back again and preaching the meeting for him. I know it'll be good. Anyone that would like to is able to attend any of those services. I encourage you to do so. We'll probably have a flyer or something from them with all the dates and times. But be praying for them. All right, like for you, if you will, this morning, want to finish up our series that we began the first of this month on the 11 habits or traits of a godly person. And this is the fourth and final segment of that series. In Psalms 15, and just 5 verses, Psalm 15 says, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor, in whose eyes a vile person is contemned, but he honoreth them that fear the Lord. He that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not, he that putteth not out his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent, he that doeth these things shall never be moved. And so we're looking at these things, and he asked the question, who? What type of person? What are the characteristics, the traits, the habits of the kind of person that shall abide in God's tabernacle, his house, or that dwell upon his holy hill in his kingdom? And so we've sought to answer that question. This morning we pick up with the last segment, he that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not, he that putteth not out his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent. Now, we've tried to, in each one, see there is a thought that connects each group. And the first had to do with kind of our personal relationship and attitude toward God. The second was our relationship and how we deal with our fellow man. The third is kind of our worldview, what's our attitude towards sin and righteousness, good and evil. And this tends to, I believe, reflect on our attitude toward material things, money in particular. Uh, Paul admonished Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6. Verse 3 through 11, he speaks of, in verse 3 said, if any man teach otherwise, other than how Paul had been instructing Timothy, and he consents not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness. And so we've been talking about what are the characteristics of a godly person. He says that he's proud, knoweth nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmising, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw thyself. So what is our attitude toward material gain, and particularly money? He says here, but godliness with contentment is great gain. Our focus, our personal attitude toward materialism should be that of contentment. To be content with the things that God has given us and has blessed us with. And understanding, if we're faithful with that, God may choose to bless us with more. And Paul says, you know, during the course of his life, during the course of his ministry, there were times when he abounded. There was support coming in, and he abounded. There was other times that I was destitute. But I learned that whatever state, condition I happened to be in, to be there with content. God has different, at different times in our lives, has different purposes, and we belong to him. And we are his to bless or withhold blessings as he sees fit for our faith, for our growth, for our usefulness in a particular time and situation. All of these things. And so he says here, godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. So what we have in between is all by the grace of God. Anyway, and so we should be content. And so he says, having food and raiment, let us be there with content. That seems to be the same that Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew, there in the Sermon on the Mount. We may get to that a little bit. But he says, having food and raiment, let us be there with content. But they that will be rich. It didn't say those that are rich. And here it's important that we rightly divide, if you will, the word of truth. That we correctly read it. That we correctly understand it and break it down, what he's saying. It doesn't say that they that are rich. He said they that will be rich. They that who have a desire. You know, if that's your goal in life, is just to become rich, you've set out a path for yourself that is full of trouble. They that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. He said, if that's your goal in life, and that's what you've set out for yourself, you think that the only thing that that you'll be happy and measure as a success is if you accumulate a lot of things, a lot of material things. If you accumulate wealth. That's what he's talking about here. Those who have a desire, and that is their goal in life, is to be rich, to accumulate wealth. He says, you're opening yourself up to temptation. You're giving Satan an opportunity to use that motivation to cause you to sin. And a snare. And into many foolish and hurtful lusts. People can, when money's involved, people can do some of the most foolish things. People that you think they're smart, they're educated, they should know better. But you have, I mean, you can look around our society today, men go into business to get rich, and they have all these get-rich-quick schemes and things, and a lot of them wind up in jail. And foolish. You say, don't you know better? You think you know better. Well, verse 10, one of those misquoted verses of Scripture. And in misquoting it, they miss what God is really saying here. Most people, and I've had people quote this to me, money is the root of all evil. That's not what it says. Money is not the root of all evil. It's like you can't get your lawnmower to start, and you start kicking it and calling it stupid and dumb. It's an inanimate object. It doesn't have any intelligence one way or another. You know, in science fiction, you might have an artificial intelligence that would run a lawnmower, but we don't have that now. That's fiction. It's an inanimate object. It's not smart. It's not dumb. It doesn't do anything stupid. It's just a lawnmower. Don't call it stupid. The one kicking it and carrying on like a nut is, you know, is the one behaving foolishly, not the lawnmower. Money is an inanimate object. It is not capable of good or evil. People are capable of good and evil. And it's the love, the lust, the greed that people have for money that is the root of all evil. And the very next line, which while some coveted after. What are you talking about? They coveted after money. What's the number 10 on the list there? Thou shalt not covet. They have erred from the faith. And pierced themselves through with many sorrows. It's not the money. It's the covetousness. So he says, out of the heart proceeds all of these things. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And I believe that when it talks about the deceitfulness of riches, again, it's not the money that is being deceitful. It's our heart. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And when our heart covets, you can convince yourself of all sorts of things. Well, this set lays down some directions and prohibitions concerning our use of money. First of all, and this was number 9 on our list, I realized that some were kind of counting these and I didn't always number them as I was going through, but out of the 11, this is number 9. It's the first of our set this today. Of all our love of money, should not be greater than our respect for our own selves and our integrity. Our love of money. Money is necessary, and I won't even call it a necessary evil because, like I said, money is neither good nor evil. but it is a necessity. Material things are a necessity of life because we have a physical body. We live in a material world, and certain material things are necessary to sustain life. It's not a necessary evil. It's just a necessity. However, our desire to obtain wealth, riches, money, and the power that comes with it should not exceed our respect for our own selves and our integrity and our reputation. Ecclesiastes 7:1. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. No, that's not right. Oh, I went too far. I flipped over to the Song of Solomon. No wonder that one didn't look right. Ecclesiastes 7, verse 1. A good name is better than precious ointment, the day of death and the day of one's birth. He says, a good name is better than precious ointment. I read that about the precious ointment. I think of the woman that brought the ointment and anointed Jesus' feet and Judas Iscariot. Said, well, that's a waste. So that's value. That's precious. That's of great value. It ought to have been sold, and then the money could have been given to the poor, but that wasn't his real motive. He was the keeper of the purse, and it says he was a thief. It's of great value. And so he's saying a good name here is better than having something of value. Your reputation is more valuable than any material thing that you can possess. And you need to guard it. And so what this first he that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not. A lot of times in scriptures talk about making a vow in the context of the idea of making a vow to God. And I'm going to do so and so. I remember I think it was when I was at my first pastor. Lou and I were young, newlyweds. Well, been married for a short time. We were learning and trying to do things. Talk about tithing. And I didn't make much. My first pastor. I remember when I first went there, my salary was 50% of the offer. The offer might only be $10, so I got half of that. That was my salary for the week. We got $50, and I got $25. I remember one Sunday, the boy, his dad was kind of the treasurer, counting the money, and he come running up to me. He was so excited. Brother Marcus, that you're going to get at least $50 this morning. Somebody put a $100 bill in the offering plate. That's more money than that kid had seen his whole life in the offering plate. You're going to get at least $50 today. So as I was saying, it wasn't all that much. And so Lou and I, we had to say, you know, as a man is purposed in his heart. And I said, you know, we give 10% and we live off the other 90%. How about if this next Sunday we give 90% and we keep the 10? That's what we purposed to do. That's what we said we agreed that we was going to do. I got the biggest income that week. Lord will test you. We gave the 90%. It was hard, but we gave that 90%. you know, if you stop and think about it, probably that 10% of that week's income was probably more than what the 90% of other weeks had been. So we survived. The Lord provided. It worked out. But that's kind of the idea of what it's talking about when you swear to your own hurt. But you don't change. You say you're going to do something, and then even if you find out later it will cost more than what you thought, you go ahead and do it. No, if you're in business and somebody comes to you and asks, can you do so-and-so for this much? And you think about it and say, yeah, I can do it. And you agree to do a job for this amount. And then in the process of buying materials, something has happened, prices go up, whatever, and it costs you a lot more than what you anticipated. What do you do? You say, well, I'm sorry, I said I'd do it for this much, but circumstances changed. The materials went up in the meantime and so on, and it's cost. No, you do it for what you said you'd do it for, and you eat the loss. That is the idea. You know, someone that, when you say you're going to do something, and the application of this, be careful what you promise to do. Don't make foolish vows. Now, one of the judges, Jephthah, made a very foolish vow. He was going out to lead the Israelites against one of the nations there that was oppressing Israel. He was the judge that was going to deliver them. But, you know, sometimes you make these, Lord, if you'll just do this for me, I swear I will, you know, whatever. Be careful. He said, Lord, if you give me the victory here, he said, the first thing that comes out the door to greet me when I get home, I'm going to offer it up in sacrifice to you. Think it might have been a chicken or a calf or a lamb or something come running out. It wasn't. It was his daughter. Be careful what you vow. Don't make a promise that you will not want to keep. And if you make a promise, keep it. Even if it hurts, even if it costs you. Your love of money should not exceed or be greater than your desire to keep your good name. Sometimes that's difficult. In fact, all three of these have to do with placing money over your integrity, your good name, or relationship with other people. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 2 says, be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God, for God is in heaven and thou upon the earth, therefore let thy words be few. Now he goes on. Verse 4 says, when thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed. Better is it that thou shouldst not vow than that thou shouldst vow and not pay. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin, neither say thou before the angel that it was an error. Wherefore should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thine hands? Now you say something like that, well, don't come back later when it's due and say, well, I made a mistake. I shouldn't have said that. Sorry, I can't do it. Many other scriptures that deal with that. The second one, number 10 on our list, if you will, he that putteth not his money to usury. put your money out, you don't lend money and then charge interest on it. And actually, some of the things that it even talks about victuals, you know, food, anything. In other words, you don't loan something and then take a fee for loaning it. If you're going to loan something to somebody, you loan it to somebody. If you're going to give something to somebody, you give it to them. You don't charge a fee. Exodus 22:25. If thou lend money to any of my people that is poor by thee, thou shalt not be to him as an usurer, neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. So don't be a loan shark. You don't loan money out for a fee, is what he's saying. Leviticus 25:35. And if thy brother be waxen poor and falleth in decay with thee, then thou shalt relieve him. Yea, though he be a stranger or a sojourner, that he may live with thee. Take thou no usury of him or increase, but fear thy God that thy brother may live with thee. So again, we see the idea, you know, if somebody's in need, you can lend, you can give, but you don't charge a fee for it. You know? If somebody needs to borrow a tool, lend it to them, but you don't charge them a fee for it. Deuteronomy 23, it adds a little something here. Verse 19, I found this interesting. Thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother, usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury. Unto a stranger thou mayest lend upon usury, but unto thy brother thou shalt not lend upon usury, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all that thou settest thine hand to in the land whither thou goest to possess it. I notice it is an interesting fact of history that in medieval feudal Europe, which was under the domination and control of the Catholic Church, they oppressed the Jewish people. And the only job a Jew could have was to lend money. So later on in Europe, Jews came under a lot of, they were despised as money lenders. That all, you know, all the nobles and kings of Europe owed money to the Jews. Well, why was that? It's because the Catholic Church made them. As one of the things when we were studying history, the history of the church, we found out how many times the Catholic Church created a situation, created something, come back and bite them, and everybody else. For that matter. But if Jews became the money lenders of Europe, it was because that was the only job they were allowed to have. But then the Gentiles wasn't their brother, and so they were still. I said, don't do that with your brethren. But somebody else, a stranger, you can. Yeah. Anyway, I found that somewhat interesting. So you don't make a profit off of your generosity. If you make a profit off of it, it's not really generosity, is it? It's not really a good deed. You're not really helping somebody. So if you lend something, you give something, you do it freely. You know, somebody might look at that and say, oh, you know, yeah, I'll let you have my tool. Thank you. I can make some money off of this, you know. The wear and tear on my stuff. Said, yeah, I'll let you have it, but, you know, I want you to rent it. You know, I'll let you borrow it, but you pay me so much, you know. You know, you see an opportunity there. No, no. He says, don't do that. And the third one, number 11, nor taketh reward, that is a bribe against the innocent. Over and over in the scriptures, we find the admonition that to God's people and in judgment, they were to use a just and righteous judgment. In Ezekiel 18, verse 5, verses 8 and 9, said, if a man be just and do that which is lawful and right. Ezekiel 18, 5. So it's identifying here, if a man be just and do that which is lawful and right, verses 8 and 9. He that hath not given forth upon usury, neither hath taken any increase, that hath withdrawn his hand from iniquity, hath executed true judgment between man and man, hath walked in my statutes, and hath kept my judgments to deal truly. He is just. He shall surely live, saith the Lord God. So here's another example where he's identifying who is that just man, which is lawful and right. Does that which is lawful and right. He executeth true judgment between man and man. Deuteronomy 16. Verses 18 through 20. Judges and officers shalt thou make thee in all thy gates, which the Lord thy God giveth thee throughout all thy tribes, and they shall judge the people with just judgment. Thou shalt not wrest judgment, thou shalt not take a gift, or thou shalt not respect persons, neither take a gift. For a gift doth blind the eyes of the wise and pervert the words of the righteous. That which is altogether just shalt thou follow, thou, that thou mayest live and inherit the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. There were going to be judges, and different things was going to be brought before them, and they were going to have to discern. But they were obligated to render a just judgment. They were not to be a respecter of persons. They were not to take a bribe or to take a gift. You know, some would say, well, that's not really a bribe. I've just given them a gift. And you're in that position, you don't take it. You don't receive those things because he says it blinds the mind. 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 3. Samuel was old. His sons judged over Israel, verse 1, verse 3. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, that is after money, and took bribes and perverted judgment. See, that was the very thing he forbade, and they did. They turned aside after lucre, the love of money, and they took bribes with the intent of perverting judgment. You know, you slip me a little money under the table here, and I'll make a judgment in your favor. Kind of like the same thing applies when we talk about governments and all and taking kickbacks to choose a certain contractor or something. That's not a just judgment. They're taking a gift. They're taking a bribe. They're perverting judgment. And many other such scriptures, but especially as we see that how this pertains to us even in the church, this attitude. James chapter 2. laid that. Now, as we read this, notice what he says here. James chapter 2, verse 1. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. For if there come into your assembly a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and you have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, well, you just stand thou over there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? So you're a respecter of persons. That is one of the things that was forbidden there, along with taking a bribe. That's not a just judgment. So don't be a respecter of persons. I said something else that's a problem and you need to watch for. And I admonish those that claim to be saved. Don't do this. You know, there's some people that are in business and they'll join churches with the whole purpose in mind of being able to network through the membership there to grow their business. You know what else? If they're going to do that, they'll look for the biggest, most prosperous looking church to join. Those people there, they got money. Well, they've been a respecter of persons. They're looking at the monetary benefit. They're making judgment calls. It should be, Lord, where would you have me to be a member that I can serve you, where I can learn and be taught and serve you? That should be their criteria, and that would be a right judgment. And by the same token, when somebody comes in as a church and we look at it, we do not give preferential treatment to those who have more money than those who don't. Don't be a respecter of persons. Because altogether, these traits, when taken together, describe the type of person that God receives and that will have a place in His house and in His kingdom. We come to the end of this study. These 11 traits or characteristics of a godly person. One who has a right relationship with God. A right attitude toward God. A right attitude and relationship toward his fellow man. A right perception of good and evil. And finally, the right priorities when it comes to money and wealth. He that doeth these things, who acts upon his convictions, God-based convictions, shall not be moved, will be stable, enduring, and blessed in his deeds. Now, James refers to a double-minded person and says they're unstable in all their ways. Let us seek to be the kind of person God would want us to be. Honest, dependable, stable, God-fearing. That is what we're called upon to manifest to the world. Let your light so shine before men. I mean, if you're saved, and we believe in the eternal security of the believer, that God has forgiven us of our sins, and we shall never come into condemnation. When we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. We can confess our sin, and He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we have a witness to the world in which we live, and they cannot see those things. They cannot see the heart of the child of God who grieves because of his sin. They do not see him going before God and God forgiving him of his sins and restoring a right relationship there. They see none of those things. We have a witness in the world. And he said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works, your good deeds, and glorify your Father which is in heaven. This is what we need to seek to do. Many times we may fall short of it. We may not be the witness that we ought to be. God give us the grace to keep on keeping on as we serve the Lord till He comes back. Let us stand together.